you haven't seen this or taken note of it already, take a read of it. I think you were in some groups, were you not, that were roughly by your age group? Is that right? Yeah, if you can organise yourselves, maybe back into them, that would help. So the maximum group size you can have is 7. So no more than 7 on one table. So if you guys need to break up and spill out onto one of these tables, then do so. So last workshop of the day, and indeed the block. So we're going to be taking a dive into focusing on the physical corner. Okay. Plan is little like we did this morning, a little bit in here, a little bit out there. Out there will be largely determined and delivered by yourself. Okay, and I'm going to give you a task once we've covered some of the theory inside for you to go away and plan and deliver and then review. Okay? The reason why I've got you sat in age groups will become apparent. Did anyone manage to watch any of this over dinner? Or was it just kind of on in the background?
I tried to figure out what it was.
Okay. Right. Just to start us off, I'll leave that one for it. It's called Zidane, a 21st century portrait. It is basically a video. A cameraman followed Zidane for 90 minutes and made a feature-length movie out of it. I'm going to leave it on for 2 or 3 minutes. Just note down what you see in terms of the physical corner. So what are you seeing that's going on physically when you watch this? If you want to share it with your peers, that's not a problem. And we'll come back to that in a few minutes.
Always.
If you want to share among your table, what did you see physically that was going on in that video? I think it cut to the changing rooms at the end there. What did you see physically going on? Just share it with you amongst your table. Pause you there. So, ignoring the fact that Zinedine did not say a word, which I've heard a few of you notice, which is good. Any of you get frustrated because your players don't shout enough? Yeah. Yeah, just consider that. In this country, we have this thing where louder is often perceived as better. Not always the case, though, is it? Okay, so just parking that to one side, then. What are some of the things that you saw physically that were going on there?
Well, firstly, he's got a great stature, isn't he?
Yeah.
You look at him, he's got a great athletic physique. He's a big, tall son. And to be like David Ginola, to have that kind of muscle and that physique, to have that ability as well. Doesn't seem to be in the correct proportion, but when you've got that,
so he's got a base to build off, hasn't he? Yeah.
He preserved his energy quite well.
Okay, how do you mean?
So he knew when to store his energy and when to recover, and then when to go and when to press. So if it was slightly further away, and he was looking a bit tired, he knew to take a step back, maybe walk through. He put up the pace so all day from where he could go.
Yeah.
But he was preparing, storing, and then waiting to go again. Whereas some of my players, because they're young, and they just run, and then they go, and then they're out of the game. And whereas he was always in play, and he was storing all the
time. He was always on the move, but he was like, it's kind of got just to sort of at that point, his movement was kind of jogging, looking around, and then
bursts around his reach.
Great.
If you look at the physical thing, take away whatever his movement was. He looked down twice, and he looked down for a millisecond twice. All the time, wherever it was, the ball was in play, out of play, whether he's running or not, whether he was scanning what was going around him. You look at it again, the number of times he does that, good players do that, just checking what's going around him all the way. He just didn't stop. He didn't seem to turn off. Physically, you can't expect it in the world. you know, one of the world's best players, physically and tactically. What he was looking at and where he was surprising.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah. And what you'll notice is the further you go into this course and you get dive into the content is that a lot of the workshops will intertwine. So what you've just said there, that probably relates back to what you covered on when you're talking about developing skill on in the block one. And we talk about the amount of time that players spend off the ball compared to on the ball. Anyone know what the percentage is?
3 minutes, I reckon, on the ball in 90-minute
man. Yeah, at the top players.
Yeah. 95% of his time he's ticking over the scan.
Yeah. But he's still performing physical movements at all times, isn't he? Okay, that burst thing, I'm interested in exploring that a little bit more. So, talk to me more about the bursts that you saw. Anyone?
I thought it like targeted bursts, what someone said before. When he needed to be, he put that in. And then, like George said, he did seem to, I kind of call it, like plodded around a little bit, just building his energy back and then burst, just at the targeted right moment, I thought.
Kind of almost like the football intelligence perhaps, where he knows right now I'm kind of supposed to go along behind these players, they've not had a look, they know where I am, and all of a sudden I'm in there, and I know he's maybe passing the end of it for me.
He's just reading the game, isn't he? He knows where the ball's going to be, he's experienced, his intellect, and he knows if he follows it and he tricks in areas, he's got the opportunity to burst.
It's interesting when you break it down physically what actually happens in a game. So it's all well and good breaking it down, looking at it on the surface. So 8 miles, you're running the game, so why don't you train for 8 miles? Well, actually, if you break that 8 miles up, it's exactly what you just said there. There's lots of walking, lots of resting, and lots of really high energy, intense bursts of power. Okay? Stop. Who wears a Fitbit? Anyone? Have you ever played like a casual game of the side or what have you with your friends and have a look at it?
No, but what I do, I can tell you, in an hour and a half session, I'll do about 8,000 steps, just coaching.
Really?
8,000 steps.
That's a long way.
Yeah, well,
it's 35 miles.
That's just walking.
To kick it a long way over that
fence. Yeah.
He's going to go chasing after
him. He's not getting quite hard to control.
Yeah.
You know,
okay. You could say, well, that's 8,500 steps of walking, but it's walk, not continuous. It's start, stop, turn around, move around. So once we start looking into the detail of what goes on, we get a bit of a clearer picture, okay? So, like we said, bursts, lots of stop, start, lots of changing direction, not just one pace. How traditionally, and certainly the older people in the room, I would imagine.
Good people.
I'm looking generally. I just caught my hat. And I've been experienced this as well. How have we traditionally trained in the physical corner? What have been our
laps of the pitch?
Right, laps of the pitch.
Indian marathons. They are the worst.
Indian marathon.
What's an Indian
marathon?
When I was a young lad. Carry on. Laps around the pitch, as you say. Laps around the pitch. Then on the coach's call, who obviously wasn't doing much, but standing on halfway, the person that was at the back had to sprint to the front. Yeah. The worst.
Yeah. Yeah, I've never heard that term, Indian marathon. Yeah. So laps of the pitch, Indian marathon. What else?
Shuttles,
doggies.
Press-ups.
Press-ups, my first youth coach, when we were about 12, we had this exercise after the laps and the shuttles. We did this exercise where we would stand in a held squat, and if you weren't parallel to the, if your thighs were parallel to the floor, you'd come and kick you. And you had to hold it for several minutes, and by this point it would be freezing cold, legs would be shaking, and some of us would be in tears, and then it would be on his command, right, 10 knees to chest, take his head. I wouldn't say it developed me into a physical athlete, that's for sure. It nearly got me leaving the game. Hill running, fell running, sand dunes. So there's a lot of interesting and traditional methods, shall we say, that we have attempted to use in a way to train or develop players physically for the demands of the game. But actually, when we look at what the game physically demands, they don't always see eye to eye the methods and what actually happens. So that's what we're going to look at in this workshop. What are the key elements in the physical development of players? How can we manipulate practices to bring about some returns in the physical corner? And what happens during maturation and adolescence physically as a focus? I had the real pleasure last Thursday night of going to assess a coach in Liverpool who was working with a group of under 16s. I actually coached that group when they were under 11s, and I haven't seen them since. So I had them for a season, and then I've missed 5 years of their development, and then I've seen them at 16. And what struck me was that there was only, it was an excellence program, so there was only six of them still in the squad from when I had them at 11s. But of the six, the majority of them at 16 moved almost identically the same as what they did when they were 11. So one in particular was very tall, and that player, as an 11-year-old, moved no different really to what I saw last Thursday night, 5 years down the line. So just bear that in mind when I give you one of the tasks in a moment. So we've got four groups. You're going to be group one, two, three, and four. Going to pop some questions up on the board. I'm going to give you, you've got 20 minutes fashion out some sort of an answer. You can use Google, you can use whatever information that you want. I'm going to challenge you to present back your answers. My judges here will be marking you on the content of your answer, the delivery of your answer, and the creativity in which you get your message across. So you will be educating and inspiring the rest of the room. Okay? If there's any questions while we're going on, you can get me. But we'll start at 2 o'clock with your delivery. Okay. Flip chart on the wall if you need it at the back. Use any resources that you want. Yes, yes. You might wish to nominate a team leader to keep you on track and pull everything together. You might just wish to do that. And time there. Don't worry if it's not a masterpiece. I'm sure our judges will take that into consideration. Oh, we have a quick dash. Okay. So, you've got a maximum of 5 minutes each. You don't have to use it, but we will cut you off after five. You decide who's going to deliver, whether it's going to be all seven of you at once, just one, or anything in between. And we'll go through the questions sequentially. So group one, away you go, and light.
Okay, we're going to look at the ABCs and report to the technical scale. The A refers to agility, which is the ability of the body to change direction, speed, stop, start, whilst maintaining balance. The B comes onto balance, which is the ability to control the body's movement while standing upright. And C, coordination, which is the ability to use different parts of the body together smoothly and differently and efficiently. The reasons that these are important for technical and development of skill is because if you think of skill development like a triangle, at the bottom you've got your ABC. And basically, without good agility, balance and coordination, you can't then develop fundamental skills. Now, the fundamental skills are throwing, catching, jumping, striking, running and kicking. So these are the kind of things you might do with kids, particularly younger ones who are, you know, they like tag games and stuff like that. So you've got to have good ABCs, which then develop the basic sort of core motor movements. And then at the top, you have your football fundamental movements. So this would be stuff like your shooting, your dribbling, your passing, etc. The reason it's particularly important for our age group is that most neural pathways are created, I think that is 5% by age 11. So if you've not got these, a good base, by age 11, you're probably not going to be a great footballer after that. One of the ways to do it is through a process called myelinization. So you create the neural pathway and dedicate to practice. It thickens the myelin sheath around the motor neuron, and the electrical impulse in your brain, to your foot, goes a lot quicker. The more practice you have, the better it goes. However, you've got to have the movement patterns in place to be able to strengthen that. And that's basically why the ABCs are important skills on.
The challenge was to educate us, and I think we've certainly been educated.
And it's on
Phil. And it's on Phil. Do you want that? Where did you get all this from?
No, that looks it.
Yeah. Put it any better. Absolutely outstanding. General to specific. Which way could we sometimes be guilty of teaching that triangle to our kids? Upside down, isn't it? And this is why I started with the story of the 16s last week, because they were no different from when they were when that neural door almost closed. So you said I'm glad you didn't say you can't be a good player, because it's very complex, and it's going player to player or person to person. But it certainly makes it harder to develop those movement skills once they get into that adolescent growth spurt.
One thing I've noticed is you get to lose real gymnastics and going to get away. You can still pick up the actual
problem top of it
by team.
And it's almost like, if you imagine this to be a house, there used to be foundations. And if the foundations are solid, we can build something really special on top. If the foundations are shaky, what we can build is going to be limited, isn't it? Do any of you coach, so you've had some with gymnastics, any of you coach players in your teams that have or done or do other sports that stick out? What
rugby or being a physical side of it, more physically active, more broadly, stronger than
tennis. What do you notice about the player who plays tennis?
Socially, he hasn't got that skill with it,
right?
Because it's an individual sport.
And what do you notice physically? Anything different?
Physically, I think it's not much different. It's quite a stop-start sport, which always supports the same.
Yeah.
You don't run always. Yeah. So physically, yeah, he hasn't had an issue, but well, that's the individual function.
How old?
10.
Yeah. Players I've coached in the past that have been good level tennis players, I've noticed that their agility and that being able to change direction laterally has been quite strong. What was yours?
Trampolining.
Got a good jump.
It hangs like a salmon. I mean, it's generally good for the core, so the develops the core, the sense of balance is really good.
So, yeah, you would tend to see difficult to get pushed off the ball.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so when we look at balance, often we assume balance is that kind of being able to stay upright, but actually, just stand up a second. Balance is, imagine I've got the ball here, come and try and take it off me. It's being able to, it balances static as much as it is dynamic. So it's really important that we build into the program, certainly of the younger ages, the opportunity to practice balance, both static and dynamic. So of those ABCs, is there an order in which they might, is there almost a triangle for those three? So do you need one before the other? And if so, what do you think?
Probably the other way around, isn't it?
Well,
CBA.
Could be. I would probably look at balance as the base.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the motivation.
It's difficult to have agility unless you've got balance, because imagine if I'm coming over here, I would topple over. So I need balance to be able to then change direction, don't I? The coordination thing, I suppose, wrapped around it.
Yeah, because I'm using multiple body parts. So just consider that, and I'm going to get you designing some practices relevant to your age groups and your maturity in a moment, but just consider that as far as the order and how we deliver these principles to the players in our care. Okay. Brilliant. If you want more information, the talent code is an interesting read that goes into a lot of depth on that, those sort of neural pathways. Scour YouTube. In fact, the guy who wrote that book, Daniel Coyle, has got a really interesting website that goes on a deep dive about loads of that stuff. And he's an interesting writer that brings the science out in an easy to read way. Highly recommend that. His website, I think it's just called The Talent Code. Yeah, worth a look at.
Just on that, mate, talking about the different sports, I've got a couple of girls actually called swimmers, and they're just head and shoulders endurance and fitness than anyone.
And what age?
Up to, well, 12, 11 and 12.
Yeah.
You can see the difference in them now, like, as well, already. You know, some of them that do a lot of swimming, they could just pretty much run for the whole game.
And it's interesting, isn't it? Because we're in this world of football, which is by and large what we call a late specialisation sport. So when do players reach their peak in our game? Around there, isn't it? Plus or minus a couple of years?
Damn.
Yeah, sorry.
A couple of years then.
Female gymnastics, and to an extent, female swimming. So two of the only early specialisation sports that I'm aware of where they're reaching their peak now. Teens. Yeah, if not below, you know, certainly in gymnastics case. So they have the argument of turning the triangle upside down, if you like, and being really specific. Yeah, I mean, kids nowadays who are serious about gymnastics, some of them are training a high number of hours in a week. Yeah. And the worry is that we feel that we've got to play catch up. Actually, no, let's recognise the great benefits that come from other sports physically that can help us, yeah, to help you become better football players as well. Okay, good. Group two.
We split it into the three groups that we've been talking about: foundation, youth development, professional, just to kind of keep it simple. And we had to Google actually what all these were, because it just didn't come naturally to think about what they were. So what we tried to do, one of the lads had done some expert Googling and talked about gross and fine, but we dismissed them. We didn't know. But gross and fine, and then we just started to have a look at from a boys and girls perspective what it might be like differently in terms of his life and things that kick in there. So we started off with balance, and we did some specific commenting on static and dynamic balancing, which was nice of you to pick out in the last piece. No, it's fine. We'd missed it earlier. We just stuck that in at the last minute. And it starts at a very early age for both boys and girls. Obviously, they need a balance, trust me, can't doubt away. Thank you. Coordination, we kicked off with them, and we worked with them. It was like an ongoing, really, but at a different level. We then decided we couldn't put crosses in boys and girls in everything, so we started to narrow it down even further then. And we looked at the motor skills of, and for that, we decided that the girls developed earlier than boys. Girls in the foundation phase, boys closer to puberty, we worked on to that. And then it was at the very end we started to talk about things like talking, vision, hearing, sight, some of the very basic stuff that we take for granted. But to be perfectly honest with you, I don't know you lot felt yesterday, but when I was out there doing our session yesterday, the guys were playing their games here, and I saw some of the things that they were doing and not adapting to, but throwing themselves into, you know, having a scream of a time, making a brilliant time. You kind of think, well, hang on, what am I taking for granted? And certainly me sight, me hearing, me talking, and that, those are the kids I work with. It was, well, inspiring. And we also were aware that, I read something, and I'm not sure if I saw the article, where Gary Neville was talking about the fact that they get vision coaches in now, a lot of the pro clubs, to try and increase their awareness and how much it affected all their games, particularly the, you know, the side at United that he came through with. So clearly from a vision point of view, that in the pro game, I think I might have missed that off, but it was over here, moving towards that. Do you want to say a bit?
Just more on the fact that the girls were developing the fine skills earlier, like hand-eye coordination. I think handwriting was the other.
Yeah.
Obviously, it doesn't necessarily apply to us with this, but there's a couple of examples. And the lads were developing the gross skills earlier, so like running, jumping, more physical type things were coming away earlier for the lads.
The majority of the stuff was obviously all relevant to people in this room, but what was started with us, and you can see without going down a list and boring the life out of you reading the chart out, what was amazing when we looked at this, and we don't know if it's right or wrong to be honest with you, there was a few that sat in, is it that group, is it that group, went down the middle, but it's quite evenly spread, but it's not all for the kids. And it's not all for when they become early teenagers, and certainly it never finishes. So this was something that I don't think I haven't considered, you know, is it the right time, is it the wrong time? I haven't sat back and looked at it, you know, what would I do if he was 9, not 14, or 14, not 18? But some of it is blindingly obvious. But I think we saw this morning from the coaching, some of the blindingly obvious stuff is if you don't take care of it and do it really simply and set it out early, you know, you're just putting man traps down for the future. There isn't much more than that, really, you know.
Any suggestions for anything to change? Would anyone do anything differently?
Any strong challenges?
Yeah.
Could be made or level. Okay. Well done. Cheers, thank you.
Pop that.
Where it's going to have the most impact.
So, yeah, what the guys have said there pretty much mirrors what we're saying here, what we're talking about, and the difference between acquiring, refining and maintaining. Okay, so if we're looking at acquiring and refining to an extent, and just have a look at your own age group where you're working and what roughly is happening. And I'm glad you didn't pinpoint it absolutely to age, because if you think about the players in your care, let's say who works with
the 12s.
Okay. My guess is that at the extremes, you've probably got plus or minus 4 years maturity-wise, at the extremes. So, example I use in the boys I look after, the 13s, we've got one boy who, I saw him last week, and it was the first time I'd seen him in a while. He's officially taller than me now. He's not yet a teenager. 12 years old, he's 5'11". He plays rugby for the region, athletics. So he physically is, you could argue, more like a 16-year-old. In the same group of boys, we've got somebody who would not look out of place playing the tennis physically. So that's the extreme. And I don't think these are an extreme case. You've probably got similar situations with your own players, haven't you? So that's why at this point in the course, we're starting to get you to consider your own players as individuals and what might they need. Okay, how we can adjust and adapt practices to what they need physically. Because this one needs something completely different at the moment to this one. But that wouldn't always be the case. Anything pop out of you from that? Would be related to the age group or the maturity that you work at?
Like balance, really, for me. I mean, going back to the first one, you know, that's what I'm saying is what you should kind of concentrate on first.
Yeah.
How the acquiring stage is
really young, isn't it?
Really young.
Yeah, and it's almost from where they can walk.
Yeah. So, looking at that, because I do some rates as well, I've got to do a lot more work, really, fine tuning balance and then getting balance, because I've got not a lot of opportunity, or we don't have opportunity to do that, really.
Yeah. Okay. The endurance one, interesting. So I've seen many a time
coaches sending the under-8s on mile hikes and mile runs, trying to get them fit, trying to improve their endurance, but actually it's not going to make a huge difference largely.
You know, we've talked about trying to avoid early specialisation and encouraging the players that you work with to do other sports. We've got quite a few boys at Real Athletics clubs. One in particular, extremely talented in terms of distance running. So his endurance, unbelievable. I can't get my head around it, but he, in his athletics club, he's on quite a rigid training programme. And it's quite interesting because I'm, through speaking to him, less so to his dad, but I do get some stuff, trying to find out what's his loading each week, so how many times he's training, what he's doing. Clearly his football is getting the benefits of the athletic programme, but he is 13, so he's an early birthday, he's clearly physically immature, and they're loading him up. And it's kind of in sharp contrast to my thinking, because I know that if you look at the endurance there, he's really just acquiring that at the moment, and they're already refining. He loves it, absolutely loves it, so for example, tomorrow evening we train. I know he loves coming to football, he wants to be there, but prior to coming to football he has an athletic session. So invariably I'll get a text message from dad, who also coaches in that club, to say he's not coming, and I'll say, well done, because really he shouldn't be there because it's the physical loading. It's a tricky one.
Athletics are nice ones, I guess, in some of the things, but I'm not sure we have been quite good ones, because I'm famous for the time of junior level. And I've seen that situation over and over and over again. Probably 10% of them go past 18 and keep them still at themselves level. And I was in age 40, and so we've been about 45 last week. You just get burned out before.
So the yellow arrows are probably the bits that might be more relevant to us. So if you've got your under sevens on a power rack doing 100 kilo squats, maybe reconsider. Okay. Right. You need to push up a little bit. Group three.
Okay, guys. Just to draw your attention to the question. Illustrate simply how manipulation of practice can have an effect on the physical outcomes. When we start looking at that, you know, we can make that the physical outcome can mean that doing more running, or the physical outcome might be that we're going to make it more intense. So it's not just how hard we're working them, it's how we're working in various areas. So you've got them all running the test. So to bring this forward, we looked at the STEP principle. We worked around that. Hopefully that will explain, give us a little bit of flow. So first of all, we understand that if we make the area larger, you've got to run further. So that's going to make you run more, and then you might get up to your 8 mile in a game scenario, if you're not me, because I was more like a little spot on the floor, and that was it. But if you want it to be more intense, you make that space smaller. So obviously you're intense, and you're probably thinking more, and it's all short, sharp stuff. So larger for more running.
Same with the smaller area. The smaller area now is fine. It's harder to find the spaces that you've got to get away from defenders, so you're constantly on the move. And it's more like the situation with the Zidane one. He stops for a second, he scans, and he goes. It's more realistic to the larger area. So if you find a space in the larger area, you can seem to just shy away a little bit, and you don't get spotted at the balls on that side. You can work there, you can stand there for 5 minutes before you move again. But in the smaller area, you can't. Same with the task. So if people are finding it a bit difficult, a bit hard, you've got safe zones. You can have safe zones in there. So that's a place where you can go, have your breather, and go, right, okay, coach, come back in and go again. Okay, to make it a little bit harder and more challenging, increase the tempo and add competition. As we know, kids love competition, so do adults. As soon as you have the competition in, you want to go that extra 5 yards to win. Okay, and keep the ball in play. Something that we did mention before that I didn't realise I do is, how many times have you watched a football match at the weekend and your ball goes out? how long do you reckon you're waiting for before the ball's back in? You know, your team striked it, it's gone past the goal, Dinkovic, and that goalkeeper's walked to bring it back. Keep the ball in place, you have more by the side, by you as a coach. So if one goes out of play, you go right back in, but ball rolling time. More ball rolling time you have, more physical exercise you're going to have, less time stopping and talking.
Yeah, just to add to something that's just come to mind, when I was a kid, I heard that the world record for goals in a game was something like 39-0, I'm sure it was Ralph Rovers versus something else. And the footnote to it was, there was no nets. If there had been nets, it would have been more. And that's something I learned 40 years ago, which just popped back into my head. It was 39 or 20, it was some ridiculous amount, but they actually said, it was on Match of the Day or something, they said if there was more nets, it would have been more.
Mike said it was 36 and he was playing it.
Mike was
playing
it.
Hey, and I was upside for 3 of them.
Cooper's coming that late. Okay, when we look at equipment, I mean, first thing that springs to mind is just throw some more balls in. You know, if you throw some more balls in, it's more intense. You know, they've got to run around it, you know, they've got to go and get them. Put goals in. You know, you put some gates in there, they've got to dribble through, they've got to do more rather than just stand there. So get them moving, get them going, give them some stuff for thinking about what they want to do on that.
For the people, we added player overloads. Because when you're under the cosh and you're playing more against you, you're going in to put more effort in. Player overload, you find yourself moving across the pitch more to cut down the spaces and the ball, and you're constantly on the move. Where it's 1-1, you can sort of let someone else do it, but if you're in a 2-1 situation, you've got to deal with them two players and that ball. A lot more stress and pressure on the player, and you've got to deal with that physically. And then, again, decreased numbers makes the pitch a little bit bigger, more time to compose yourself and have that breather. To make it harder, increase it, you've got to try and get away from the ball.
We purposely kept that below the 5 minutes because to stay in line, what we've learned is called less is more, and it's something I've been telling the wife for years. So on that note, let's leave.
Okay, I'm sure you guys got the access to the slides here because everything that's come out so far is
exactly
what
we're saying.
So, you mentioned the intensity, so we can also increase or we can adjust the frequency, so the number of repetitions of whatever it is that they're doing, how intense that they're doing it, and what type of time or for how long that they're doing it for. And we can do that, like the guys have said, by manipulating any or other combination of the step principle. I'm not going to go on too much on that because we'll come on to a further task that will link to the practical just in a moment. Okay, over to you guys.
Okay, so what we were, task number four, so we were given adolescent growth spurt, so we found a definition. So the definition is adolescent growth spurt is a rapid increase in an individual's height and weight during puberty. So we decided to focus on pre-adolescent growth spurt and post. Ignore this little bit of a drawing now. We decided pre-adolescent growth spurt, you're probably quite comfortable with who you are and who you are within the team. You probably can control the ball all right. You fit into the group, you know where you are socially.
So socially in pre-puberty, we looked at how you're there to enjoy yourself, playing with your friends and everything. Whereas during puberty or after puberty, you might become a social standard, so you might become the big person in the group, or you might have developed later than others and feel a bit down about it. There might be certain expectations. Pre-puberty, you might be one of the best players. Whereas during or after, you might not develop, as we said. That might be expectations, let's say. And it could be distractions due to puberty and social media can have a big impact as well. Physically, we'll do the similar sort of thing. Obviously, you're a lot smaller, you're less developed, your muscles and bones haven't quite developed fully yet. And then during or after, joint muscle pain, so I mean, you're not performing to the standard that you were before, and also be bigger, so there's more high end weight on him, so we may not be able to carry yourself across the pitch as much.
I read that you go from the outside in or something, so your feet and your hands go bigger before your spine's the last thing to go. Then we were saying, sort of, you could be one of the smaller guys if you're younger. So you're always sitting back from the ball, and you're never going to win anything. But a season and a half later, you're being told, come on, get back and defend this, come on, get back and defend it, and then you sort of like, you don't know what to do. So some of the coaches got to work on that. That's it.
Okay.
Okay.
So what we know is that all of them are going to go through adolescence at some point. What we don't know is particularly when it's going to happen or at what rate. So an example of the road to work could be, as you've already said, I think a couple of the groups have already mentioned it, females will go through their road to work earlier than males. It could be early, late, smooth or erratic. And that will have an impact right across the four corners of that individual. I'll give you an example. In my own school year, when we were in year 10, which is you turn 15 in year 10, so essentially you're 15, there was a boy in our year who was one of my best friends, similar physical attributes to me. He was in all the school sports teams, really popular, everyone got on really well with him. In the summer holidays between year 10 and 11, he went through the craziest growth spurt I've ever witnessed in him, anyone. And he shot up. It felt like about 4 inches of him. He was like 5'9" to kind of 6'3" overnight. Honestly, it was incredible. Not literally overnight, but over a few months. So he had a very rapid change in size. Guess what happened to him? As a football player,
lost coordination.
He was like a newborn foal. He barely stand on 2 feet. Yeah, no balance whatsoever. He was playing in a new body, essentially. So as a result, his technical toolbox went out the window. He couldn't get his place back in any of the school teams. So as a result, how did that affect him?
Confidence
went through the floor. So it had a really damaging effect in the sight corner. And then socially, he became a recluse. So we had a quite a strong-knit social group of friends that played in the same teams together. Sport was kind of the glue that bound us. He took himself out of that. He got himself into substance abuse, dropped out of school, got expelled, got in a lot of trouble. Managed to get back on track, but he didn't actually get back to any sort of ability, football-wise, until he was about 23. So it took him about 7 years to get over one summer graduate. And that again, that's a really extreme example. And I guess the warning sign I would give you is try not to make too many assumptions. So we assume often that because they might be the biggest in the group, that they're the most socially mature. Well, that's not always the case. So, but what we often do is we equate size with maturity. And we go, off you go, go lead them, or go play up a year. And sometimes it might be that they need the opposite. Think about the positions that they play in and how that affects or influences their physical toolbox. So this boy that I've just mentioned, who's in our current 13s, this season is the first time I've met him. So he was playing under a different coach for all his journey in football to this point. I guess he's always been the tallest, and he's probably going to be the tallest in his group because he's got big mum and big dad. That's where he's played. His whole life. He's never played anywhere else. So we've gradually tried to move him out. He's played left wing recently. You know, he's the tallest left winger you'll ever see. It shouldn't, but unfortunately it looks bizarre. because we have this tendency to play big down the middle, and actually that can inhibit their potential physical growth as well as others. So I know you would have spoken about position rotation earlier on in the course, it's probably been a hot topic, but it's just as important for physical reasons to think about the movements that they make, that maybe a fullback might make compared to a centre back, compared to a centre midfielder. One tends to operate on 90 degrees, one tends to operate on 180, one tends to operate on 360. It has an influence on the types of movement that they make. So just by moving them around the pitch, we can help develop a broader physical toolbox. Okay, so task for you. What time is it now? Okay, we want to be on the pitch, ball's rolling at.
Yes, sir. forced you into being agile in that young time.
So you had the man marking.
Good, okay, so fully in the hand.
Yeah.
Right, because if you play that game with foundation phase kick, how much of the time would the ball have been out of play? Because controlling that round thing with these things is quite difficult. It's probably more difficult than being able to hold the ball. You actually increase the frequency and the time by just putting the ball in the hand. Also, let's say I'm a blue. Make it spread out as if you, so you know that I'm going to stop you from getting the ball. Your movement now, if I've got ball in the hand, has got to be blocked.
Right.
Yeah, but it's got to be exaggerated because his wingspan is going to be greater than his foot span. Yeah. All right. So your off the ball movement is exaggerated. I'm going to bring in a couple of little rules. We'll see how it goes. Just for a minute, on top of ball. So, first one we're going to bring in is no head height. We'll go with your head. So no balls over your head height. Okay. Second rule is, and I like your idea about being able to move the ball. That added another dimension. So we're going to restrict you now. Every time you get the ball, you must take at least two steps. So both feet must leave the floor at some point. Got it? Yeah. You must take two steps. Get tagged on it though. Ready? Go. Okay. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, fight!
Where you are, you can just go to that for us, right? Right, okay. Now I'm going to add a little